So, Thomas More, he's a fascinating fellow. He's a scholar, a lawyer, later becomes a dogmatic defender of the faith, and he dies being beheaded by the king for his faith. But when he writes Utopia, he's a relatively young man. This is 1515 and 1516. He's English, and he's sent to Flanders for some sort of diplomatic mission for the king. And at that moment, he's actually contemplating whether he wants to become an advisor to the king, which later he does, and it doesn't work out well because he gets his head chopped off for it. But in any case, at that moment, he goes to Flanders on this diplomatic mission, and it falls apart. So he's stuck there for a number of months. And so he sits down and he starts writing this book. And Utopia is a very odd book. It's actually two books with a lot of ancillary material, like poems and letters and so on and so forth, in front of it and in back of it. And when we usually think about Utopia, we think about only book two. And book two is the description of this island of Utopia, where everything that Europe is different, or everything that Europe isn't actually is in Utopia. For example, there's no private property. There's freedom of religion, which becomes quite ironic because More himself ends up persecuting Protestants. It is a place in which everybody has meaningful work, in which there's access to education. It's a place where women actually, in limited conditions, can take leadership roles. It's Europe turned upside down. But there's also book one of Utopia, which was written after book two, probably written when Thomas More went back to England. And that is where More, who is a character in his own book, actually meets this fellow, Raphael Hithloday. And they get to talking. And they start talking about whether it's a good thing to be a king's advisor or not, and what makes a persuasive argument or not. And what's fascinating about that discussion, which nobody reads, everybody just skips to book two, okay? What's fascinating about that discussion is that Hithloday tells this story about going to a dinner party where he tries to convince everybody at the dinner party about the injustice of European treatment of criminals. For at that time, essentially, you were beheaded for anything. He says that this actually does not work as a deterrent. There's a much more humane way. No one in the dinner party listens to him. He makes these rational points and arguments, and some people are drunk, some people are just fools, and so on, and the whole thing sort of comes crashing down. And Thomas More says at that moment, he says to him, well, you can't tell people what they don't want to hear. It's like people come for a comedy and you're giving them a tragedy, or they come for a tragedy and you're giving them a comedy. You have to speak in a way that people actually will listen to you. And what's really interesting about that sort of point that More, the character, is making in his own book towards Raphael Hithloday, who's not a real person, is that he uses this theatrical metaphor, which is of a play. And then book two starts. And lo and behold, what does Raphael Hithloday do? Instead of trying to convince people through logic that the European system doesn't work, he actually creates a play. He sets a stage and invites the reader into this made-believe world where everything is topsy-turvy. But because you enter into it as an experience, like going to a movie or going to a play and losing yourself in that play or that movie, it takes the audience and actually makes them feel what an alternative would be like. It doesn't explain to them why it should be an alternative. It already is an alternative. It's natural. And then it embeds the reader into this alternative world and makes it their own. Now, what's interesting about Utopia is that Thomas More doesn't allow you to stay in that world. And this is the brilliance of Thomas More's Utopia. So he invites you into this phantasmagorical world that he's created. But then he goes about deconstructing it even as he's creating it for you. The first deconstruction is the name, which which is utopia, which is a word that's made up by Thomas More out of the Greek for ou and topos, basically meaning not, no, or not, place. So utopia, from the beginning, we're told, is no place. Then Raphael Hislide, which in the original Latin is Hislideus, is a play on the Greek for huthlos, which means nonsense. And I forget what the other, the dein, I think, which means purveyor of or something of that nature. I might have gotten that part wrong. But basically, Hislideus translates out as a distributor, means distribute, a distributor of nonsense. And so immediately, we're told that this place that exists doesn't exist, and we're told that this place is being described by a person who's a distributor of nonsense. And so it casts the reader into this really interesting place, and there's lots of these little tricks and little paradoxes throughout the entire book, that you both believe it and disbelieve it at the same time. You're there, but you can't be there at the same time. And what I think Moore's brilliance is that he's basically created a machine for imagination. That is that he's brought you into a place, and now you can imagine that there could be a different world to the world you inhabit now, but then he's kicked you out again and said, well, my place is no place, but you can't go back home to your old place because you know that there's a possibility of a different place, and so you're going to have to imagine it yourself. And I think that's the real brilliance of Utopia, Thomas More's Utopia, is it's basically a technology for imagination. It's a machine for imagining other utopias yourself. And I think he understood that at the time. Now, critics for 500 years have been arguing, is Thomas More's Utopia serious or is it a satire? And there's a lot of evidence on both sides, okay? So the evidence for the side that it's serious is that Thomas More was a devout Christian. And the world of Utopia is based upon the sort of primitive communism of Christ's disciples. And even in Utopia itself, while they don't have any one set religion, when they introduce Christianity, they're like, that seems pretty good to us because what Christ was doing was more or less what we're all about. You know, they don't become Christian, okay? But they're like, it's an okay religion, we get it, right? So it's really hard to imagine that Thomas More, who's later to give his life for his faith, would actually set up the community of Christ as a satire. It just doesn't make sense. And there's also this incredible veracity. He describes how windows are made. He describes the type of towns people have, how many people in the towns, what sort of jobs they have, down to these minute details. He's really at pains to try to make the world as real as possible. And so one school of thought has argued that Thomas More was absolutely sincere in all of this. And any absurdities he did throw in there were basically a way to, you know, tarry aside any sort of criticism he would have. Because what he's arguing is a relatively heretical thing to argue. He could always say, well, I was just kidding. Can't you tell? I called the place no place, right? But that's an old technique of all sorts of activist artists, right? Is to say, well, can't you see it's just satire? Can't you see it's just comedy? Don't you get it? Give me artistic license. And meanwhile, you're going ahead. Chinese artists, for example, do this a lot nowadays, which is you can't have political dissent in China. And so what you do is you call it art and you get away with it. Right. So in any case, that's the argument for the sincere. But there's also, and this is much more recent argumentation, sort of revisionist history of Utopia, which is calling it satire. And so the argument goes, well, Thomas More actually is quite cynical. He's basically saying you can't have a utopia, that all utopias are phantasmagorical, and really the only thing we can have which is real is Europe, 16th century, right here, right now. So my take on all this is both are right and both are wrong. That the genius of Thomas More is that he's holding both in his hands simultaneously, is that he's actually conjuring up a real alternative, yet at the same time not allowing us to escape into that alternative by deconstructing it, thereby creating a space for us to imagine our own alternatives. Okay, so I think of it as a play because what it does is it essentially introduces characters, and then we're launched into a scene. Now, as a play, it's rather boring, okay? There's no dialogue. There's one or two sort of anecdotes where there are is dialogue, but by and large, book one, which does have a dialogue, right, is very different from book two, which is a description of the scene. So it would be a very boring play. But I think of it as a play insofar as what a good piece of theater does is it creates a world in which then envelops you. And that world becomes yours. If you think back to Aristotle, you know, what makes great tragedy? Tragedy is the very thing which you can identify with the character, where his or her struggles become yours, and your struggles are then projected upon theirs. And that's the sort of, you know, catharsis or purgation. And I think that's what Moore is doing with Utopia. And so I always think of Utopia as a space I enter into, just like I would enter into a theater or enter into any sort of immersive spectacle, which, you know, a good novel can do that. There's no doubt about it. A good novel creates these sort of utopian spaces. Science fiction in particular travels exactly in the sort of creation of the what if space. Could it be like this? Why not? Yet I like to think of it as a play because I think, you know, there's that moment where Moore introduces the idea of a play, and then Utopia takes its right turn to go to a different play. So that's I think my favorite part of the book is, there's a couple. One I've already related to you, which is the dinner party, which just fails. The absolute failure of trying to convince people of anything. So that's one of my favorites. In book two, actually Utopia itself, probably my favorite is one of the few stories, sort of stories within stories, which gets told, of these ambassadors who come to Utopia. And they want to impress the Utopians, so they wear all of this gold and silver and finery. Little do they know that in Utopia, the only people that wear gold and silver chains are slaves, and what silver and gold is also used for is to make chamber pots. And so you have these, you know, these ambassadors trying to impress all of the Utopians, and the Utopians don't know what to do with them until a little boy, and this sort of prefigures Hans Christian Andersen's The Emperor's New Clothes story. A little boy says to his mother, he says, "Who are these people? Why are they dressed?" And she says, "Shh, they're the fools," or something of that nature. And it's sort of, it's a classic inversion, which seems to be a marker of status in this world is actually what you shit in or shit upon. And then my final little thing that I love is that there's a scene about chicken raising. And it's just one of those little weird details where in Utopia, sometimes people raise chickens and the chickens become so bonded to them that they follow humans around thinking that they're their own parents. It's just like, what is that detail doing there, okay? And I remember thinking for hours trying to puzzle out, like, what did this mean? And I realized, man, maybe it means nothing. Oh, one more thing. Here's my other favorite part. There's so many favorite parts, okay? So I got two more favorite parts. The more I think about it, the more favorite parts I have. So the original Utopia had marginalia, which was quite common in text at that time, okay, to write something in the margins, and that was part of the printed book. And most scholars think that the marginalia was written by Thomas More's friend, Peter Giles, who also shows up as a character in the book. What's interesting about the marginalia, radically uneven. Sometimes it's actually insightful, sometimes it clarifies things, and sometimes it's just, it feels like someone's just filling out the page. And it happens in a succession, which is it starts out very insightful and critical and explanatory, and then it sort of drops off, and then it starts up again. So I have my theory, which is totally unfounded, which is Peter Giles is writing this while drinking. And that Thomas More has asked him to, you know, because Peter Giles has written some of the prefatory letters, but he's probably, Thomas More has asked him to write Marginalia. And he's doing it while he's drinking, and he goes through, and he's into it, and he drinks a little bit more, his eyes start to glaze over, he just puts some Marginalia things, and then he just sort of passes out or gives up on it for the night, and then the next day he starts over again. A completely unfounded theory, but it's one of my favorite theories. Final favorite part. In one of the letters, Thomas More writes a letter to Peter Giles, and he says, I want to make sure I get all the facts right about this book. And there's a moment in the book in which Raphael Hithloday explains the span of a bridge. I remember it at X length, I forget what the length is, but my servant remembers it at Y length. Next time you see Raphael Hithloday, can you make sure to ask him, what is the actual proper span of the bridge? And it's wonderful because it's playing on this idea of that this is factual, right? But of course, the reader knows at this point that Raphael Hithloday doesn't exist. And so they're asking a non-existent creature to actually give us the truth about a non-existent bridge. And it sort of, it really gets at this sort of mix of fact and fiction that happens throughout all of Thomas Utopia. Utopia, you know, it's a term that we use and apply to all sorts of fiction after the fact of utopia. But most of utopian fiction, and I'm thinking of like Edward Bellamy's work in the 19th century, or any sorts of science fiction, Ursula Le Guin, for example, or sort of the realized utopias which have happened throughout history, whether they're the small communes or, you know, the Soviet states or Nazi Germany or what have you. All of them take utopia as a place which can actually exist. That is, this is a good plan to follow. You take Edward Bellamy, for example. He's writing about this world where engineers have figured out everything, and it's a much more rational, wonderful, planned economy and social life than anything in 19th century. And so it's offered up as a plan for the future, right? But utopia is a plan which can never be enacted, utopia the book. And that, to me, is the secret of utopia, is that Thomas Morris understands that utopia is always on the horizon, right? That it can never actually be reached. And so, therefore, we shouldn't kid ourselves that we could actually create it. On the other hand, he takes pains to make it seem real enough that we want to reach it. And that's the paradox at the core of the book Utopia, which is often lost in utopias, whether they're fictive utopias or actually, you know, realized utopias that happen later in the world. Because the problem is once you actually look at utopia as a plan which can be accomplished, you close it down. And once you close it down, you can either reach utopia or you can't reach utopia. You've attained utopia or you haven't attained utopia. And anybody in a utopia who says it's not utopia, they must be insane and off to the gulag with them. Whereas if you look at utopia as this sort of point on the horizon, then it always is something which is going to be undertaken and developed and expanded and so on and so forth. It's a job never done. One of my favorite quotes about utopia is from Eduardo Galeano, the Uruguayan poet who just died last year. And I'm not very good at memory, but I'll give you the paraphrase of it, which goes something like, utopia is like the horizon. I walk 5 steps towards it, it retreats 5 steps back. I walk 4 steps more, it goes back 4 steps. What good is utopia? That's what it's good for walking. And what Galeano understood, and what Thomas More understood, is that really what utopia is good for, it's good for walking. It's good for being a lodestone which to orient your compass to, but it can never actually be realized. That doesn't mean that one doesn't walk towards it. You do walk towards it. You have to have utopia as a point on the horizon, otherwise you just go like this, right? But never mistake an ideal for an actual thing that exists and can be attained. I always had very good drug experiences, personally. So when I use the word hallucination, it's a very positive thing for me. Insofar as what a good drug trip allows for, what a dream allows for, is it allows you literally, you know, think about how LSD works, okay, or hallucinogenics. It essentially scrambles your synapses. And so you're making connections which are not rational and reasonable connections. And therefore you're seeing perspectives which may not exist in reality as we perceive it, but could exist in reality if we perceived it differently, right? And that's what utopia does, is it allows us to perceive reality differently. You know, utopia is great, absolutely necessary, if you believe that this society has to be changed. You have to have something to look to, look toward, move toward in order to imagine something different. But I would argue that utopia is absolutely essential, even if you think this is the best of all possible worlds. Because how can you argue that this is the best of all possible worlds unless you can imagine another world of which this is a better one? Otherwise, you're just engaged in sort of I want to say blind faith, because you have faith in something which you can't know anything other than that thing, and you're blind to anything else. Let me explain it hopefully a little bit better than that, which is, it's easy to be faithful in something if it's the only thing which is. But the true test of faith is actually when there's another alternative and yet you say, I like this one better. If you like something just because it's the only thing that is, it's not really, you don't really have any great belief in it at all. You just, it's like believing in gravity or having faith in gravity. Well, it is. So it doesn't, it's not a test of intellect. It's not a test of belief. It just is. It's everything. And so without any sense of an alternative, we can just get trapped into thinking this is the best world, but we never get to test it. I personally don't like capitalism very much, right? But if capitalism is the only system that is, I can't even defend capitalism, because it's like, as I said, defending gravity. What are you going to defend it against? Whereas if there's alternative systems, socialism, anarchism, fascism, and so on and so forth, and I say capitalist democracy, liberal capitalist democracy, is the best system, at least then I'm comparing it to these alternatives. And I think one of the things that's happened in our times is the collapse of alternatives. You know, Margaret Thatcher very famously said, there is no alternative, right? And she was putting forth the neoliberal ideal, which is incredibly successful in the wake of the fall of the Soviet Union, which is, there really is no other alternative. Yes, there's some people, you know, that want to create an Islamic state over there. There's some folks in North Korea who are living in some sort of la-la communist, you know, dictatorship land, but us, rational people, we all know that liberal capitalist democracy is the only game in town. That's a very dangerous place to be, okay? And that is the place where we are at right now. Because then when the system fails, it just, you have this immense sense of malaise, because what else is there? And so it's always healthy, even if you support the system you're in, to have a sense of alternatives which you can say, not that, but this. Criticism served a very critical function for many years. It was a bulwark against the sort of excess of faith, excess of belief, whether it be in communism, whether it be capitalism, whether it be in fascism. It was a way that intellectuals in particular could point out the flaws in any given system. And so it had a real radical function at that for many, many years. But I would argue, actually, that criticism doesn't have a critical function at all. That in fact, criticism in the absence of alternatives just becomes cynicism. That is that our, you know, neoliberal capitalism, for example, criticism just becomes a way that we can believe in a system in which we know is not the best of all possible worlds. It's sort of a, it makes it more palatable. That is, I live under it, but I'm a critic of it, okay? And this is, you know, this is what left-wing academics live on, right? Which is, yes, I'm part of the system, I'm part of producing and reproducing capitalism, but I don't really believe it, and I teach my students not to believe in it either. My point would be that that idea of an excess of belief, that you have to somehow strip away the superstition, strip away the false consciousness, speaks to a different world. We don't have false consciousness. We don't actually even believe in capitalism. it's just the only game in town, okay? It's like, as we said before, believing in gravity or believing in the stars. It just is. Criticism only has a radical function when there's an alternative to which one critiques one system in order to suggest there may be a possibility of the other. Without utopia, criticism basically is masturbation. Well, masturbation is actually quite fun, okay? And maybe that criticism has that function, but it's not very procreative. That is, it's not going to create a new world. I think that's a really great question, because I think that the problem with utopia, Thomas More's included, is that there is no criticism. They figured it out. What is there left to criticize? We're living in Denmark, right? You know, and although Denmark certainly is, that, you know, now that they've banned all of the immigrants, obviously there's criticism is now in full fling. In any case, back up. Pre-Denmark. that in utopia, whether it's Thomas More's or all these other utopias, actually criticism disappears. And I think it disappears for exactly the reason you pointed out. We've reached the final place, and so therefore there's nothing less to say. And of course, at that point, it becomes totalitarian. At that point, it becomes a closed system. Again, that happens within Book 2 of Thomas More's Utopia. But if you imagine Book 2 as bracketed by Book 1, and bracketed by all the letters and the name Utopia, then all of a sudden, criticism is part of it. Because constantly you're saying, it can be and it can't be simultaneously, right? That's why I think Thomas More's Utopia is so brilliant, as it's figured out how to both create a phantasmagorical work, which seems perfect, yet also engender a sort of criticism. Criticism can have a radical function again. It can have a radical function when it's constantly building towards some sort of an alternative. But when all it does is parasitically feed upon the dominant system, then it's lost its critical function. I think it's better to say it's not about criticism versus utopia, that is, some sort of critical engagement with a world that is versus a naive belief in a world that could be. But that actually what Thomas More shows us is a way that you can operate both simultaneously. You can both believe and also interrogate. The Italian communist Antonio Gramsci once said, in order to be an activist, you have to have a pessimism of the intellect and optimism of the will and have these in operation at the same time. And that's exactly what a utopian criticism, which is equally grounded in constantly reflecting upon, is this the best that we can have? Can it actually even be real? At the same time, its function, its driving sort of force, is to move forward out on that horizon. Criticism or protest is the thing which legitimizes democratic power. That hegemonic democratic power, which is the world that we live under, in the United States at least, most of Europe, in order to distinguish itself from totalitarianism, has to allow critique. And not because it puts up with critique, but it depends upon critique in order to legitimate itself as that we have won the battle of ideas. I'll never forget, I think it was 2003, there is a build-up, huge protest for the build-up of the war in Iraq. And George W. Bush, after the protest, I mean, we're talking millions of people in the streets around the world, says this is exactly what we're fighting for, the ability to speak one's mind and have a protest. And it was total spin, it was total reframing, but he got at a fundamental truth, which is he can claim legitimacy as a leader of a democratic state because he allows for protests. And he can allow for protests because at some level he knows that they're not, as a stroke of criticism, they're not all that effective. Because in the end, it's about no, stop this, as opposed to yes, this is what we're for. Which is why I was so inspired by the globalization movements that I was part of, but also the occupation movements, both in the Middle East and in Europe and the United States. Because those were moments that was, you know, asking the question of, or putting forth the statement that a different world is possible, which are much more utopian statements. The globalization movement that I was part of, we didn't have the answer. The answer in places like Tahrir Square and Zuccotti Square were very short-lived, right? But they were performances of a possibility. They were utopian ideas being enacted, and they were stage sets. You know, I used to go down to Zuccotti Park every day, and it was like entering a stage. You know, literally having the performers over here, people doing yoga over there, you know, people having prayer rugs out there. It was like, it was a performance. It was a performance of a different world. It was a fantasy. Absolutely, right? But it still, it allowed me to enter into a different space, which wasn't solely just critical. And I think that those occupations were much more frightening to powers that be than the protests, partly because they just don't know how to police them in the same way, but partly because it's in those moments that people can imagine that there can be an alternative, as opposed to, we don't like what you're proposing. It's suggesting we do like this, and that's radical. Have I ever witnessed utopia? No. That's why I wanted you to ask that question. but I've performed utopia many, many times. So in my other life, when I'm not an academic, I train activists and I train artists to think more like activists and activists to think more like artists. And I work with an artist, Steve Lambert, and together we have this thing called the Center for Artistic Activism. And we get invited by groups to go around the world and work with them for about 5 days, training them to think creatively about activism. And we always end our project with a 24-hour, we end our training with a 24-hour project where we have to brainstorm, create all the props, build and execute a political action. Altogether, because the problem is that activists will spend months on a protest or a demonstration, something like that, and we want to get people to think about it much more in terms of sketches, right? Just you can blast one out in 24 hours. We can do it, and so on. So one of the things that we never know what we're going to do until we're actually there, because it actually comes out of a brainstorm with the group. But in a couple of places, in Macedonia and in St. Petersburg, Russia. The things which came out of these projects were a creation of utopia. And so I'll tell you about the Macedonian one. So in Macedonia, we were working with LGBTQ activists and Roma rights activists. And Macedonia is a pretty terrible place to be queer or to be Roma. And in fact, it's the second worst place in Europe after Russia. And when we talked to the activists about what the project they wanted to do, they were just—they were so angry at being alienated from their own country that they were like, "We just want to tell people to go fuck themselves." You know, the proverbial middle finger to the people that were doing it to them. Like, okay, that's great, but you basically got locked into this cycle where they're saying you're not the real Macedonia, you're outsiders, and then you're saying to them, "Fuck you, we don't want to be part of you." And it's like, well, you just made their point, right? So then we sat down and said, "Okay, how can we think about this differently?" And they said, "Well, the problem with Macedonia is that it was being recreated before their eyes in this weird sort of nationalist fervor, which included these massive statues every place to, like, you know, symbols of Macedonian virility, you know, big men on horses and women with boobs suckling, you know, children, and just phantasmagorical ideals. And we feel left out because we're building a country built on sort of hate and nationalism. And so they said, well, why don't we create our own country? And so what we did in the busiest park of Skopje, the capital of Macedonia, on a Saturday afternoon, is we created the future republic of the former Republic of Macedonia. Macedonia can't call itself Macedonia because the Greeks object to it, because they think the Macedonia is the part of Greece. And so they're called the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia, which everybody in Macedonia hates for obvious reasons. So we create the future Republic of the former Republic of Macedonia. And we had a frontier we had passports, and the passports you could do gender, but it was on a scatter plot, not male, female, and it was in pencil, so you could erase it. We had a border guard, we had music, we had information booths, so you could actually talk to a queer person or talk to a Roma person about what their experience was. We had games for kids to play, and we had a big pedestal for a statue. But instead of a statue on it, we had stairs so people could go up to the statue and hold these signs which said, "I am a hero, heroine of," and then they would write whatever they wanted to. And it was a huge success. It was actually the most successful demonstration these groups had had in 10 years. They had hundreds and hundreds of people coming through their, you know, the frontier, getting their passports stamped, and then joining our country. It was also, the activist said, it was one of the most fun protests or demonstrations they had ever done. It really was a demonstration insofar as it demonstrated the world they wanted to bring into being. It also only lasted 3 hours, and it was a fantasy, right? And so that's part of performing utopia as opposed to like discovering utopia, is understanding that it's going to end, and then you re-perform it the next day, and you re-perform it the next day, and so on and so forth. And so I like these ideas of utopias that you perform as sort of stimulants to the imagination, because they get us thinking about what's possible. Now, in the end, if life is going to change for Roma and LGBTQ, it's not because they have a little utopia in a park for 3 hours. In the end, it's going to change because you change laws, right? But you can't imagine what sort of new laws you want to change until you can imagine a world that you want to live in that would have those laws as natural and present. And so this is not utopia as a replacement for sort of hard-headed activism that's got to be done, but really as a stimulus to it, mm-hmm. as a place to imagine what kind of world we would want to live in, and then go from there backwards and say, well, in order to get to that world, what sort of laws do we need, and how are we going to actually bring those laws, into being?